إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. Praise and glory to Allah, most gracious, most merciful. And peace and blessings of Allah be on His Messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. We are deeply thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for witnessing the month of Sha'ban. And we continue to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we see and live and worship Allah in the month of Ramadan. A month that is full of blessings. This is the last Friday before Ramadan. And Ramadan has been made more special than any other month because of the Quran. The Quran was revealed in Ramadan, and it is said that the first verse, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق, was revealed on the 27th night of Ramadan. Our relationship with the Quran has to change. Many of us like to finish reading the Quran once, twice, three times, 10 times in Ramadan. And whoever can do that, may Allah bless him or her. But there is a different point, a different relationship that we need to have with the Quran. The Quran is a miracle. It has not only one miracle, it has so many miracles in it. It has scientific miracles, it has social miracles, it has linguistic miracles. But the most important and beautiful miracle of the Quran is you and I. Because whoever uses the Quran as a tool to change his or her life, they become the best people ever walking on this earth. They become successful in this life and the hereafter. And the Sahaba and our dear Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the perfect example of that. A man like Umar ibn al-Khattab, who used to worship a god that made out of dates that he would eat from it, who had the intention of going and killing Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Here's the Quran being spoken by his own sister, Taha, ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتخشى. He hears those verses. He gets moved. It changes his life. He goes to Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. He becomes the Izzah of Islam. The Sahaba says, after Umar ibn al-Khattab became the believers, they could practice their religion outside in Mecca. He gave them izzah. And then after the death of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he took Islam to so many places that they believed and adored it. To those who do not believe in the miracles of the Quran, Allah gave them a challenge. The Quran has a challenge in it for all humanity from the time it was revealed to the judgment day. If you don't believe that this Quran is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, go and take the challenge. And the challenge was made easy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَاهُ قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِعَشْرِ سُوَرٍ مِثْلِهِ. If you say that the Prophet has made up this Quran, go and get 10 surahs like the Quran. They couldn't. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَى فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِثْلِهِ. Just get one surah. And then get something like it. And still, no one so far has been able to defeat this challenge. Telling humanity that this Quran is a total miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to treat the Quran as a message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ أَنْزَلَهُ الَّذِي يَعْلَمُ السِّرَّ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. It was revealed unto you by the one who knows the secrets of the heavens and the earth. He is the most forgiving, the most merciful. The creator of those whole universe, the creator of us, the maker of us, has been gracious to us to give us a manual to lead our life with. When you buy a car, a phone, a TV, anything you buy, you expect to get a manual of how this device operates. We are a very complicated being. We have a manual. And our manual to live by is the Quran. If we don't follow the manual in our devices, we don't get the most out of them. And anybody who has a phone knows that. There are many secrets in your phone that and features, unless you read the manual, you won't know about them, or a friend tells you about it. The Quran and us are the same thing. The more that we adhere to our manual, the more that we are successful. The more that we neglect our manual, the more that we live in the misery that we are living in it right now. The Quran was revealed on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in stages, in times. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam experiences an event, and the Quran comes to tell him how to deal with that event. We like to read Surah Al-Kahf every Friday, right? The Jews came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and challenged him with three questions. We all know that. And the Prophet said, I'll let you know tomorrow. Because he knows Jibreel alayhi salam will tell him the answers of those questions. Tomorrow comes and the answer is not there, Jibreel didn't come. Time passes by and the answers are not there because Jibreel did not come. And the Prophet gets worried, and the Jews and the people in Medina also are saying, what's happening? They're starting to doubt the prophecy of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Jibreel comes and tells وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهِ. Don't ever say I'm gonna do this tomorrow except with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's how we learn, that when I'm gonna, when I promise something for tomorrow or for the day after or for anything in the future, I should say inshallah. Inshallah with good intention, of course, not like some people would like, if they don't want to do something, they would say inshallah. No, if I say inshallah, I have the full intent to do it and to fulfill the mashi'ah and the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how we treat the Quran. The Quran is part of our life. It is the guidance of our life. We need, as we come to Ramadan and we read the Quran, it is nice to read it the way the Sahaba read it, the way the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam read the Quran. There are two features of the right way of reading the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا. Recite the Quran in a good manner. Like, feel it while you're reading it. Like, enjoy it while you're reading it. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was passing by Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. And Abu Musa was actually combing the hair of his horse, like us doing any trivial job. But while he was doing that, he was reciting the Quran. Like many people, when they do stuff that they just say songs. No, he was reading the Quran. But he had a very beautiful voice. So he was reading it in that beautiful voice and the nice tajweed. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam just stood there without Abu Musa noticing and just kept listening to the Quran and enjoying it from Abu Musa al-Ash'ari's recitation. Then after a while, Abu Musa noticed that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was hearing him. So he said, oh Prophet, I didn't know that you were listening. He said, the Prophet tells him, أُوتِيَ مُزْمَارًا مِنْ مَزَامِيرِ آلِ دَوُودِ. You've been given a voice and an ability to recite like the people of Dawood alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us Dawood alayhi salam used to recite the Quran, and says the Zabur in a way that the mountains will make tasbih with him. So he was telling Abu Musa that you were reciting it such a beautiful way like the people of Dawood. So Abu Musa told him, O Prophet of Allah, if I knew that you were listening, I would have even said it in a much better and nicer, in a nicer way. لَحَبَّرْتُهُ لَكَ تَحْبِيرًا. The Prophet encourages us to read the Quran in a beautiful way. زَيِّنُوا الْقُرْآنَ بِأَصْوَاتِكُمْ. Beautify the Quran with your voices. لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ لَمْ يَتَغَنَّ بِالْقُرْآنِ. It's not among us who recite the Quran in a right, I wouldn't say in a songing way, but in a say that it comes out of their heart. And when Umm Salama, the wife of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was asked about how would the Prophet recite the Quran, she said he would recite it little by little. And she explained it, like when he recites Al-Fatiha, he would say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and he would stop, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and he would stop, and he would recite it in a very little by little way, so that it he internalized it. The other feature is tadabbur, and we'll get to that. Another way to enjoy the Quran, and we should treat it as such, is to imagine the Quran. And this might be unusual for people. How would I imagine the Quran? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, and it's a done deal, that He has given us so many stories in the Quran. نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ بِمَا أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. We tell you the best of stories when we reveal this Quran to you. And after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had a very hard time with his people, Allah revealed for him the Surah Yusuf, which is, whoever reads Surah Yusuf knows it's just a story from its beginning to the end. It's a sequential story. Doesn't have like in other places of the Quran, the story begins, then the reflections, then other stories. But no, Surah Yusuf, it has the story of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam from his childhood to when he became when he was in Egypt and was reunited with his brothers. The story is full of emotions. A father, just like all of us, most of us are fathers, who sees that his own children have problems among themselves. Envy in a very bad degree, that they killed their own brother or attempt to kill their own brother and waste another brother. He was so saddened by it that he lost his sight. Can we feel these emotions? If we are away from our parents, do we feel the loss that they feel when they don't have us with them? When we read Surah Yusuf, when we are not with them, they yearn for us, and they want us to be with them, and they feel part of this loss. So the surah and the Quran, all of it, has so many feelings. We need, when we read those stories, to imagine them. To imagine them as they happen. We read a lot of stories, and whenever we read a story, our mind goes and makes characters and makes events happen. But when we read the Quran, we don't make our mind imagine. For us to get the full benefit of the Quran, we need our mind to start imagining those events. And by imagining them, we are able to feel it. And why do we want to feel it? Because the objective of the Quran is to move this, is to move our heart. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, لا تنثروه نثر الرمل ولا تهدوه هذا الشعر قفوا عند عجائبه وحركوا به القلوب ولا يكن هم أحدكم آخر السورة. Don't just read it. Stop and look at its wonders. And make it move your hearts. Don't only be worried about when will I get to the end of the surah. There was a very happy occasion that happened to the Sahaba of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when we read this verse, we should feel the happiness of the Sahaba when they passed, when this verse was revealed. So there was this Sahabi who loved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam a lot. He loved him so much that he would miss him. So he went back to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, I love you so much. I love you more than my family. When I go back to my family, I stay with them, then I miss you, so I come back just to be with you." Then I said, Sahaba is saying to the Prophet, "Then I thought about it, when we go to paradise, you will be in a very high place, the Firdaus and near Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I'm just a regular person. I will not be able to see you when I go to paradise. What will happen?" And it was such a moment that even the Sahaba who heard the question thought, what will happen? That is something really, really hard on them too. They will not be able to see Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet had no answer to them. The answer came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. Whoever obeys and Allah and His Prophet, he will be with them. So it was a full rejoice for all the Sahaba when they hear that. All what they need to do is just to follow Allah, believe in Him, and follow the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they will be able to see Him and we be with Him in paradise. And so will we also once we do that too. So when we read the Quran and we pass by this verse, we feel happiness. Also, there are points that we start feeling sad with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ نَعْلَمُ إِنَّهُ لَيَحْزُنُكَ الَّذِي يَقُولُونَ فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يُكَذِّبُونَكَ وَلَكِنَّهُمْ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ يَجْحَدُونَ. We know that you are saddened by what they say. But no, it's what we refer right now as it's not personal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the Prophet, it's not personal, it's not against you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, إِنَّهُمْ لَا يُكَذِّبُونَ. They don't think that you're a liar. No, they just reject the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why. So don't take it personal, don't be affected, don't feel sad. And whenever we're saddened by event around us, this is something that we need to remember. So the Quran comes as a guidance for us, as a helper, and as a way for us to interact with life in a very good manner. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروا. Alhamdulillah wa kafa wa salamun ala ibadi alladhina astafa. Praise and glory to Allah, most gracious, most merciful. And peace and blessings of Allah be on His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A very important feature of the Quran is tadabbur, is to reflect upon it. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Don't they ponder, reflect on the Quran, or they have seals on their hearts? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam treated the Quran in this manner. He would reflect on it. The first verse that came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق. We all know this verse. خلق الإنسان created the human being from alaq, a clinging matter. Our dear beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam cannot at that point know what alaq means. Alaq is a clinging matter, and there was no way for him to know that one of the stages of embryology, the embryo as it's being created in the womb of a mother, one of its stages that it becomes a clinging matter. Allah is challenging him to reflect on the verses and the creature, to read the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the creation around us from the first verses that were said. And that's why one night when Bilal came to him in the morning and he found him crying, he was crying so much, and asked him, why, what happened? He said, it was revealed on me last night an ayah, إن في خلق السماوات والأرض واختلاف الليل والنهار لآيات لأولي الألباب الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار. And the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are signs for those who have intellect. People who remember Allah day and night on their sides, and they say, oh Allah, you have not created all this in vain. We need to think. Thinking, reflecting, pondering. And this is really deep. This is people found cures. I'm just gonna give one story on this. An ophthalmologist, a person who treats eyes, was moved by the story of Sayyidina Yaqub alayhi salam, how he regained his sight in the story of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam. So he saw that Sayyidina Yaqub regained his sight. So as a man who is interested in treating people's eyes, that's something that's very important for him to learn and discover and understand. So how can Sayyidina Yaqub alayhi salam regain his eyesight after the shirt of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam was put in him? I mean, yeah, there are miraculous things, but there are also things for us to understand. What could be in the shirt that makes Sayyidina Yaqub regain his sight? Well, if you think about it, our sweat goes onto our shirts. So he analyzed the sweat and he found a chemical in it that can cure eye diseases. He patented and he made medicine out of it that is being used right now. This is came out of reflecting in the Quran. We need to really read the Quran in a very reflective manner, and all whatever your field of study is, whatever you're studying or your life sustenance out of it, Allah has put miracles in the Quran, has give us guidance in it in all our fields of knowledge. We just need to absorb them. The last item of how we treat the Quran is the way that it becomes it gives us its full effect, is to live the Quran. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we all know, was a walking Quran. When people ask about his manners, they said he was just a walking Quran. His manners are the Quran and the Sahaba. So the Sahaba dealt with the Quran this way. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says something in the Quran, they changed our lives according to the Quran. And whoever goes to Masjid al-Qiblatayn, there is a masjid that is known right now, it is Masjid al-Qiblatayn, that you go and see how the people in that masjid in Medina, they heard that Quran was revealed, that the Qibla has changed, so they changed the way that they were praying while they were praying. The order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no more drinking alcohol. They threw the alcohol on the streets. The order came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that women or sisters or ladies should put their covers. The woman who did not have anything, they took the curtains and they put them around their heads before they left their houses. One Sahabi heard the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, reciting, "Man dhal ladhi yuqridu Allah qardan hasan," who will give Allah a loan, a good loan. A good loan means you loan something to Allah, Allah will give it back to you. And he heard that and said to the Prophet, "Does Allah ask us for a loan?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Okay, I'm making you witness that I loan my garden to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." So he made his garden. His garden had 600 palm trees. And he made all those as waqf to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And incidentally, whoever goes to Medina right now and ask about this waqf, the waqf of this garden is still giving fruits and have made other waqf for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he loaned it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just because he said, he heard the Quran says, who will loan a loan to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He gave it all to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how we treat the Quran. It's not, we treat it as a way that it moves and changes our lives. Once we that, we attain the full, we become the miracle of the Quran. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us full beautiful miracles of the Quran, so that we can lead very successful lives in this life and in the hereafter. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamana wa ansurna ala alqawm alkafirin. Allahumma ati nufusana taqwaha wa zakkiha anta khayru man zakkaha anta waliyuha wa mawlaha. Allahumma arina alhaqq haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ah wa arina albatila batilan warzuqna ijtinabah. اللهم إنا عبيدك أبناء عبيدك أبناء إمائك ماض فينا حكمك عدل فينا قضاؤك نسألك اللهم بكل اسم هو لك سميت به نفسك أنزلته في كتابك أو علمته أحدا من خلقك أن تجعل القرآن ربيع قلوبنا وجلاء أحزاننا وذهاب همومنا اللهم علمنا منه ما جهلنا وذكرنا منه ما نسينا وجعله قائدا لنا إلى رضوانك وجنة اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا وارحمنا وارحمهم وادخلنا واياهم في جناتك العلى اللهم اغفر لموتانا واشف مرضانا وفك اسر اسرانا بعزتك وجلالك وقدرتك يا عظيم يا جليل ان الله يامر بالعدل والاحسان وايتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم ولذكر الله اكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون واقم الصلاه